Well, good morning. What do you say we get things started?
Oh, pass me the coffee.
Welcome in to Talk of the Town with Henry Hinton.
This show will have laughter, tears, arguments, infections caused by jacuzzi water.
This is Talk of the Town with Henry Hinton on Talk 96.3 and 103.7.
Okay, welcome back. 8:05. We are continuing our election coverage here on Talk of the Town this morning. And we'll recap some of the big stories for you this morning. And we're going to talk to some other folks around the state of North Carolina. And we're hoping to have Tom Tillis on. Tom has not responded. We did get our new lieutenant governor on, Mark Robinson, a minute ago. We've had some of our legislators and Congress folks on. And we'll continue to do that for you. Also, Brad Crone is going to be on later this hour. Brad is one of the smartest political analysts in the state of North Carolina. And we're going to talk to him in just a couple of minutes. If you're just joining us for the first time and you missed kind of my opening monologue this morning, here's where we are. The state of North Carolina is still very much in play. And here's why. Even though Trump and Tillis hold a pretty good lead right now in the state of North Carolina, the mail-in ballots are not being counted yet. All of them are not in, and we don't know how many of them are out there. And they will continue to be counted until November 12, 9 days, which is one of the longest in the – there was one state, I can't remember which state it was, maybe Nevada or somebody that was going to count them up to 10 days. But North Carolina, I mean, most of the states were going to allow – like Pennsylvania, for instance, they're going to count the mail-in ballots for 3 days. And so Friday we'll know the answer to the all-important question of who won Pennsylvania. – But we're not going to know who won the presidency, I don't think, this week. And both sides are already threatening that this is going to go to the courts. So, you know, again, we may be sitting here Thanksgiving morning not knowing who the president of the United States is going to be sworn in January of 2021. I think it's really possible. We've said it's that close all along, and it is. Now, in the state of North Carolina, you might say, well, you know, Trump and Tillis have a fairly comfortable lead, about a point and a half each. But here's the point that I made last hour that I want you to keep in mind. Trump won nearly every state, maybe not New York, maybe I think even California, with same day voting yesterday with people that showed up in person and voted at the polls. It's unbelievable how well he did yesterday. It's also unbelievable how poorly he has done with the mail-ins. Biden has won every state with the mail-in ballots. So what's left to be counted in North Carolina and Pennsylvania? Mail-in ballots. So you can't say that Trump has won North Carolina. You can't say Tillis has won the Senate race. You just can't. I want to, but you can't. And so that's where it is. The other big story, of course, Cooper won re-election. The Republicans won just about every other council of state race. The attorney general's race is still a little bit too close to call. But it looks like we have a chance to take, the Republicans do, three seats out of the seven seats on the North Carolina Supreme Court. The big one there, of course, is the Chief Justice spot, the race between Paul Newby, who is a sitting justice, versus Cherie Beasley, who, of course, is the current Chief Justice of the North Carolina Supreme Court. If Paul Newby wins, he gets to control the agenda and has a lot to say about what is heard and not heard at the Supreme Court level. That would be a very big coup for the Republicans, based on the fact that right now the Democrats have a 6-1 lead in the North Carolina Supreme Court. So that's a story to watch. But again, we can't declare victory for he or Phil Berger Jr. or Barringer, the three Republicans. It looks good right now, but you can't say they've won because of these mail-in ballots. The other thing, I've said this on the show and I still believe it, it's more important for Republicans to win the United States Senate than it is to win the presidency. I mean, everybody wants to win the White House, and I understand that, But if you lose the United States Senate, you got big problems. You got huge problems.
Yeah. And you made that point earlier this week with Tom Tillis.
And again, you know, as we sit here this morning, is the United States Senate going to stay in control of the Republicans? You can't say that. It looks good. Tom Tillis's race looks good. Tommy Tuberville won down in Alabama. But, you know, a Hickenlooper won in Colorado. Mm-hmm. He's a Democrat. The astronaut won out there in Arizona. What's his name? Mark Kelly. It looks like he has beaten Martha McSally out there in Arizona. And so Republican big flips, of course, are the fact that former college football coach Tommy Tuberville has won the U.S. Senate race down there over the Democrat Doug Jones. And that is the biggest flip probably in the country for the Republicans in the Senate. Let's see. In the House, there's just no question that that the Democrats are going to continue to control the House, and so you got four more years of, or at least two more years of Nancy Pelosi. Lindsey Graham was able to win that Senate race down in South Carolina. This guy, Jamie Harrison, had $107 million spent against Lindsey Graham.
I thought it was going to be enough to...
And Lindsey Graham won by like 5 points.
Yeah.
South Carolina came through big for Trump. They came through big for Lindsey Graham. You know, North Carolina, it just shows you the difference between North Carolina and South Carolina. You know what it is? Mecklenburg and Wake County. They ain't got a Mecklenburg County in South Carolina. They ain't got a Wake County in South Carolina. And again, you know, you have to remember that two of the 100 counties in the state of North Carolina hold 21.5% of the total popular vote in North Carolina. We talked to Chris Humphrey a minute ago, and Chris Humphrey was, of course, he won his House race in spite of the fact that the Democrats threw a bunch of money at him. Perrin Jones has lost his race for House here in District 9 in Pitt County, which is probably the saddest thing that happened last night to me so far. But the North Carolina Senate will maintain, the Republicans will maintain control of the North Carolina Senate and in the North Carolina House. It looks like the Senate right now is going to end up 28-22 Republican, and I had the number a minute ago. What was the number in the House? Let's see. In the House, the Republican majority is now going to end up being 69-51. Now, that's huge for many reasons. Again, it'll keep Roy Cooper from rubber stamping some crazy things and getting some crazy things done, particularly if the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court race holds up with Paul Newby. But the really big news about North Carolina Republicans holding on to both chambers in the legislature is the fact that we have redistricting coming up.
2021, new lines.
So, man, you know what? I hope something's done about this Pitt County District 9 district. I really believe that Brian Farkas was able to win that. You know, I really thought maybe that the Democrats might be able to buy that seat with the amount of money that the outside money coming into Pitt County to try to beat Perrin Jones. But when you look at the other outside money and the fact that people like Bob Steinberg won, people like Richard Hudson won his congressional race, Joyce Krawick won over Winston-Salem in the North Carolina Senate, those were what they called potential flips for the Democrats. And they spent millions. I said this last night on the North Carolina Network. They spent over $2.5 million to beat Bob Steinberg in District Senate 1, which is comprised of, you know, my home area where I grew up, Edenton, Elizabeth City, Hertford, Currituck County, Dare County. How do you spend $2.5 million in media money in those counties?
I don't know.
How can you? Carl Mishka is the chairman of the Republican Party in Congressional District 3 here in Eastern North Carolina. And Carl joins us this morning. He was with Congressman Murphy last night down at the Beaufort Hotel. I don't know where you are now, Carl, whether you're still partying like it's 1999 or whether you're headed back home in New Bern. Good morning to you. How are you?
Good morning. We're on Front Street in Beaufort. It's a beautiful morning down here, as it is nationwide. And I'm real proud of District 3, but you hit the nail on the head when you talked about State House District 9, because Perrin lost, and we have to keep that good man in the Senate, or the House, I'm sorry. And so redistricting comes up, and it's going to be very important. It's going to be very, it'll be monumental, but most importantly, in District 3, with the exception of a couple counties in which we didn't perform as well as the others. Lenore was a little bit soft on our ticket, and Elizabeth City did what Elizabeth City does. However, I'm so proud of all the groundwork that my colleagues did and the candidates we presented.
What do you mean by Elizabeth City did what Elizabeth City does? It went blue.
Yeah.
Yeah. It normally goes blue, doesn't it?
Yep.
But you know, that's isn't that the only part of that district that really is blue? Because you take a look at Gates County, Perquimans County, Chowan County, Currituck, Dare County.
They're
those are red counties.
They definitely are.
But Pasquotank is blue, huh?
Yep. And
wow.
We lost a couple of important referendums down in Carteret County, which I thought were marketed very well. I was disappointed with the outcome, and in Craven County,
what was lost in down there? I want to hear about that. What were the referendums?
Yeah, they had one was a sales tax issue to help on the budget and do some infrastructure work, and of course they marketed it based upon the fact that the residents wouldn't end up paying for it.
Yeah,
most of the money would come from visitors, which is all true, but it didn't work well. And then,
so that bond did not pass in Carteret County. That bond referendum for the was it half cent sales tax?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And what about the dredging? Was that on the ballot? That was on the ballot too, wasn't it?
It was, and I don't recall. I'm in the car now. I made notes earlier this morning, and I'll misspeak on that one, so I'll pass.
Yeah. Okay. I think the biggest loss for us here in Eastern North Carolina, the biggest loss for we Republicans is Perrin Jones. Everybody else looks pretty good. And then statewide, Carl, what's your impression? I've been saying that, you know, people who are saying that Trump and Tillis have won in the state of North Carolina, they better hold on to their tongue a minute, because if you look at the nationwide trend, these mail-in ballots have been Democrat ballots.
That's probably the case. However, I think there's enough of a margin, and let's switch races for a second. I am so pleased with the results of the North Carolina Supreme Court.
Still too close to call, but right now, all three Republicans on the ballot are leading. But I mean, they're razor thin margins in those races. But I tell you, I've said from the beginning that potentially the most, you know, the least talked about and most important race in the state of North Carolina was Paul Newby's race for Chief Justice of the Supreme Court.
And that, of course, is the thinnest margin of all of them. It's in the 3,000. It's in the four digits instead of five. The others look to be performing a little bit better, and I'm disappointed with the gubernatorial race. However, we gained some council seats, and I know that you and I differ very much in our personal relationship with our treasurer, and I was going to call you about that last week, and I let it pass, because, Henry, what you have to realize is the argument you have with him taking a position that Biden has, I think that's all passed, because in the first of the year, isn't it a federal law that there's transparency in all?
Yeah, well, let's you and I talk about offline. I will say this. I didn't vote for the Democrat. I'll just say that. I couldn't vote. I couldn't vote for the Obama guy.
So. I'm glad to hear that. It is a side conversation.
But I did vote for one Democrat. I did vote for Beth Wood because I think Beth Wood is a fabulous auditor.
And she's a good auditor, but I'm always disappointed with her overlooking or not reporting the global Transpark situation when it occurred and she was aware of it. It's a little bit like...
Let me put it to you this way. Without her, Alan Thomas might still be the director of the Global Transpark. Does that make you feel better?
Yes, it does. You just put a smile on my face. And I guess we're ranging all over the place, but that's what talk radio is all about. Going back to 3rd District Republicanism, I just am so pleased with the performance. I mean, yesterday my job was handling problems, and there were none. My best sidekick, Bob Pruitt, took care of a problem that we had, and I just sat by the phones and did a little bit driving around. But everything it's amazing how few occurrences we had compared to previous years, and the performance of the voters getting the leaders getting the vote out, and of course we had tremendous candidates.
Yes,
we had our candidates were above par and without fear, and we just left Congressman Murphy right before you reached out to me, and he and Wendy and they've got smiles on their face, and I told him if I don't see you beforehand, I plan on seeing you on January 20 in a North Carolina ball.
Yeah, having Greg Murphy represent Eastern North Carolina in Raleigh is huge. And I want to give a little shout out to Sandy Smith. She ran a really good race in District 1. You know, we thought that it might be more winnable than it had ever been before, but that is such a Democrat area of the state, and they've got that thing drawn to protect G.K. Butterfield. But Sandy ran a good race. I mean, she raised a lot of money on her own. She ran really good radio and television ads. She worked really hard, and she's a newcomer to politics. But, you know, I thought Sandy did the best job of anybody ever in trying to win that district for Republicans.
Well, it's up again in 2 years.
Yeah. All right, Carl Mishka, the chairman of the North Carolina Republican Party in District 3. Thank you, Carl. And
thank you, Henry.
Let's talk some more later. We'll argue about the state treasurer later, okay?
It's a moot point. I just had to make my point because I'm very protective of that man when you look at what he has accomplished for this state in the various assignments he's had.
I'll tell you, but Pitt County has taken it on the chin. We have taken it on the chin on several points in the last couple of years, and I'll just leave it at that. And you know, losing Perrin Jones in the House is a huge blow to us. All right, Carl, we'll talk later.
Have a wonderful day, sir.
Okay. 8:23, let's get a break in. We'll come back. McGee will have news headlines. Brad Crone is going to join us. We're still hoping to have Tom Tillis. Tom might be sleeping right now. But I did text him to see if he wanted to come on. Hopefully, you know, again, his race is still. He said last night he's won. And it's very possible that Tom Tillis has won, but again, until these mail-in ballots come in, and we may have to wait till November 12th to find out, we don't know for sure. So stay with us. Same thing with the president's race here in the state of North Carolina. All right, back with more right after this.
Get out and drive at Greenville Toyota. We'll get you out of your trade with up to thousands more than it's worth. We need trades now more than ever, and we'll pay you more for your trade than you ever thought possible. It's time to get out and drive at Greenville Toyota.
Top Dog Academy provides training services and daycare for dog owners in and around Greenville. The Top Dog facility, located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bellsport, is a comfortable, healthy environment where dog owners can feel secure about leaving their pets. Top Dog Academy teaches people how to have a better relationship with their dog. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
We are a team. We are a unit. We are a family. No, literally, we are a suburban family of football fans. That's our neighbor. Hi, Bob. And that's the inflatable screen we forgot to properly secure.
Pepsi, made for football. Watch it.
Music for your workday with Mark, Mark, and Laura, Beth McCall, and Dylan McKay.
The most music for your workday plays here.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
Greenville Toyota wants you to get out and drive. We'll get you out of your old car so you can drive a Corolla, 149, RAV4s, 219. Plus, get out of maintenance fees and drive with the Greenville Advantage at Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.
This is where Eastern North Carolina comes to talk.
Coronavirus.
It's on the police.
This is Henry Hinton and Talk of the Town on Talk 96.3 and 103.7.
Or more election analysis coming up. Brad Crone is coming up in just a few minutes. Brad, of course, has handled governor's races in the state of North Carolina, but he's really one of the best at analyzing what is going on. We're going to see what Brad thinks about these outstanding votes, these mail-in ballots, and how it could affect the presidential race here in North Carolina as well as the U.S. Senate race for Tom Tillis. A couple of things. My buddy David Fulcher down at Carteret County, we were talking about the Carteret County referendums that were on the ballot yesterday. The school bond passed, and the sales tax referendum, the quarter cent sales tax, failed. That was where part of that was to do dredging along the waterways, which is badly needed in Carteret County. That's a big part of their income is resort income and fishing and things like that. And people were, some areas, Carteret County got to be dredged, and they were going to use some of that sales tax money to do that. That did not pass. And, you know, with the Carteret County county commissioners, very unlikely to pass a very unlikely to pass a tax increase down there. You wonder where that money's going to come from to do some of the things that needed to do. So we'll have to follow that story. Scott Parker up in Elizabeth City says that for the Steinberg race, I was asking how you spend $2.5 million in that market in District 1 in the U.S. Senate. I mean, North Carolina Senate. He says that that the Democrat was advertising on all the Norfolk television stations.
I thought some of that money had to go into Virginia. I mean,
you know, that's kind of crazy though. But I you know, having grown up there, I know that.
Sure.
People up in Elizabeth City, Nags Head, that area, they watch the Norfolk television stations.
I grew up watching Wavy TV 10.
I watched Wavy. I watched Channel 3, Channel 13. Yeah. Those were the stations we got. Now, these days with satellite, I think people get more of the NCT, WITN. Yeah. I know my mom does up there. She's got the satellite up there, and she gets those stations. But she also gets the Norfolk stations. So that's where the money was spent. And let me tell you, Norfolk ain't a cheap television market. It's more expensive probably than anything in this area. Not more expensive than Raleigh or Charlotte, but Norfolk is a huge metropolitan area, almost 2 million people. So it's kind of crazy to think that they spent money on the Norfolk TV stations to win a North Carolina northeastern corner rural Senate seat. And by the way, it didn't work. So think about all the money that the Democrats and George Soros and the money coming in from California and New York and everywhere that they poured into eastern North Carolina. And I think we can say it didn't work anywhere. I don't think that's why Perrin Jones lost. I just think his district was screwed up. since the last redistricting. That's what I think. I could be wrong. 8:30. We'll ask Brad Crone that in a minute. 8:30. Let's check some news headlines. What else you got this morning?
All right, complete but unofficial Pitt County results from Tuesday's election show that Brian Farkas has defeated Perrin Jones for the NC House District 9 seat. State Senator Don Davis defeated challenger Karen Kozel in the State Senate District 5 race. Candy Smith defeated Tony Moore in the House District 8 race, and incumbent Chris Humphrey won District 12. Also in Pitt County, Tom Colson, Beth Ward, and Lauren White retained their seats on the Board of Commissioners. Another statewide race is Republican incumbent State Representative Ed Goodwin held on to his seat in the North Carolina House District 1 race against challenger Emily Nicholson, and Republican incumbent State Senator Bob Steinberg defeated Democrat Tess Judge in the Coastal First State Senate District. Overall, North Carolina Republicans withstood a massive effort by Democrats inside the state and nationally to retake both General Assembly chambers. Election results on Tuesday showed GOP candidates winning majorities in the 50-seat Senate and 120-seat House. Republicans will also be in charge of drawing lines in 2021 when the state is likely to add another congressional seat. And in national news, Henry, Oregon became the first state to decriminalize small amounts of cocaine, heroin, methamphetamine, and other drugs. The Oregon measure would make possession of small amounts of would have long been considered harder drugs a violation similar to a traffic ticket and no longer punishable by jail time.
Heroin.
Heroin.
So we now have a state that's legalized heroin.
Small amounts.
Welcome to America.
But it's heroin.
Welcome to the new America.
And that's all it takes. I know.
Yes, that's crazy.
It is.
That's absolutely insane. But I guess we should not be surprised at anything these days. All right, let's check our weather update. Beautiful day today. Sunshine, about 70 for a high. And overnight lows tonight in the upper 50s. It'll warm up toward the weekend. Tomorrow we've got sun and clouds and 72. No chance of rain. 20% chance of rain on Friday, but temperatures up around 75 again. And game day Saturday here in Greenville, 75 degrees and sunshine. Going to be a beautiful day for ECU football as the Pirates will host the Green Wave of Tulane at 12 noon. And, of course, we'll have all of those games for you. We have all the pregame coverage starting at 9 a.m. on 94.3 The Game with our Doug Henry Pirate Game Day Countdown. And that'll be 9 to 11. Then the network will come on at on 107.9 and 94.3 at 11. And then after the game, McGee is back with our Pirate postgame call-in show. So we're going to be talking about a victory.
I think so this weekend, too. I feel good about this.
I think the guys, if they
and put, I haven't said that the entire season.
If they can put last week behind them, you know what I'm saying?
Yep.
All right, news and weather service this hour, the Tire Realty Group and property management team. Tire Realty Group continues to offer the most extensive marketing plan to get your home sold. They sell a house every 24 hours on average. It's just unbelievable. You list it, sell it, and move on when you list it with the Tire Realty Group. They've even got what they call their TRG offers program, where they'll offer you cash without even showing the house to anybody. But the big thing for me is if I list my house with somebody, I want somebody I know is going to be aggressive in selling it, aggressive on selling it quickly, aggressive on selling it and getting me the best price. And that's why I would choose the Tire Realty Group. Call them today, 252-758-HOME. It's 252-758-4663. Or visit them online at TireRealtyGroup.com. That's T-Y-R-E, Tire, and start packing. 8:34. Brad Crone, one of the top political minds in the state of North Carolina, next to tell us what is going to happen with these mail-in ballots. And he'll analyze the entire evening for us right after this.
We are a team. We are a unit. We are a family. No, literally, we are a suburban family of football fans. That's our neighbor. Hi, Bob. And that's the inflatable screen we forgot to properly secure.
Pepsi, made for football. Watch it.
Top Dog Academy is Eastern North Carolina's complete dog training facility. Top Dog provides an excellent environment for dogs of all ages with training services and workweek daycare. Top Dog is located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bells Fork, and features a comfortable, healthy environment and a spacious facility for daycare and a brand new, beautiful facility for training. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
best music for your workday with Mark, Mark, and Laura, Beth McCall, and Dylan McKay.
The most music for your workday plays here.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
Of hunger and poverty starts here. Your gift of an animal from Heifer International can help a family start a small business, creating food and income for education, medicine, and more, all while caring for the earth around the world and right here at home. Heifer International. Learn more at heifer.org.
It must be time to get back to Talk of the Town with Henry Hinton.
He's kind of a diva.
He's absolutely fascinating.
Ultimate gentleman spy. Irresistible to women, deadly to his enemies, a legend in his own time.
You won't believe what he's going to say next on Talk 96.3 and 103.7.
Well, the stock futures have been all over the place in the last 12, 14 hours. Since the polls closed last night, the stock market really was optimistic about a Trump victory, I think, up 950 points in 2 days. And now the futures have been kind of all over the place. The Dow right now, the futures today look like up like 192, but it's been up, it's been down. I think the stock market is very, very jittery over what's going on with the presidential race. Let's go to Brad Crone. Brad, a good friend in Raleigh. Brad is one of the brightest political minds in the state of North Carolina. He owns a company called Campaign Connections. And Brad, of course, has handled governor's races in the state of North Carolina, lots of legislative races. And he has a unique perspective because he's one of these guys that digs down deeper than most of us to kind of analyze things. Good morning, Mr. Crone. How are you?
Good morning. It's great. Interesting night at the state legislative level.
Yeah.
While most pollsters, pundits, including myself, were expecting a lot more competitive legislative election, the Republicans kicked butt last night and held on to majorities in both the state House and the state Senate.
Looked like 28-22 in the Senate, Brad?
Correct.
And Carolina Journal says 69-51 in the House. Does that sound right?
Correct.
Yeah.
Right. And, I mean, the House actually gained seats. And,
yeah, but we lost, you know, we lost a big one here in Greenville with Perrin Jones.
Yeah, Perrin Jones.
I tell you, that was the worst thing that happened last night. I saw it coming. I was worried about this race all along because of the district, the redistricting. You know, it's frustrating that Greg Murphy won that district, and it was kind of a swing district, and then they moved it to more like a Democrat district, which put Perrin behind the eight ball. I thought he still had a chance to win because he was going to get the Democrat and unaffiliated vote. It was just too, I think the redistricting was too much for him to overcome. I can't say it was the outside money because, the outside money didn't work anywhere else. It didn't work in Steinberg race, didn't work in the Richard Hudson race. So, I mean, you agree with that?
No, Henry, I agree with you, exactly. And that was, the Democrats knew that they had the potential to pick up that seat there in that district. And I think that's the only Democratic pickup in the state last night.
Yeah.
But clearly, when they redrew the district, it amplified independent vote and Democratic vote. One thing that I found really intriguing last night was the Republican turnout operation late in the early vote and then same day. And it just overwhelmed. You saw it throughout the night as same day vote came in. Haven't seen yet the final total on same day vote for the general election, but it was just massive. You look at the Council of State seats that were open, the superintendent's position and the Department of Labor, you know, they started out down 200 points and made a 400,000 vote gain throughout the night.
Yeah.
I mean, just absolutely impressive. And my hats are off to Jim Blaine and his company, the Differentiators, because they were fighting a rising tide. They went to battle, and they delivered the state Senate again for the Republicans. And, you know, from my perspective, I respect that tremendously.
Never count Jim Blaine out, right? I mean, and for folks who don't know, that's a name that most people in the state of North Carolina don't know, but it might be the most important guy in the state, because Jim is
he's the Republican
consultant for the North Carolina Senate and longtime chief of staff for Phil Berger, but now he's out of that job and doing what you just said. Now, let's talk about
the interesting race was the governor's race to me.
Yeah.
I mean, Forrest closed the gap. Everybody had the governor up 11 points. And at the end of the night, I think it was right at a 4-point margin, 200,000 votes, 250,000 votes. But he was outspent almost 5-1.
Yeah.
So if the Republicans had had a candidate who could have generated more cash to be competitive in the fundraising market, I think the Republicans could have ended up winning the governor's seat last night.
It's just a real anomaly, isn't it, that the Republicans did so well everywhere except in the governor's race. I just have to think that Cooper's free TV time for the last 6 months.
Absolutely.
And his, his fear tactics of, and you know, what's he going to do now is the question. Is he going to try to shut the state down again?
And that's going to be a real big question mark. And I just don't think after the vote yesterday that there's any appetite for that whatsoever.
Well, the good news is, we could have a Supreme Court that would be a little more likely to take Roy Cooper on that if we end up going down that road. But again, the three Republicans winning the seats in the North Carolina Supreme Court, that's too close to call. They're leading, but it's kind of like the governor's race and the Tom Tillis race right now. You really can't declare them the winner because of these mail-in ballots. And Brad, I've been making the point all morning. You made the point about the ground game and the same-day voting that took place yesterday for Trump. But it's exactly the opposite nationwide for the mail-in ballots. It looks like Biden dominated that, and that's what we're waiting on here in North Carolina.
Right, and there are probably 80,000 mail-in ballots. I was talking with Carter Wren last night that are still out there, possibly as high as 100,000. And we really won't know that until November the 12th, or really November the 13th, when the county boards do their canvass, and then the state will certify on the 17th. The couple of interesting races that I followed last night was the lieutenant governor's race.
Yeah, we just had Mark on, by the way.
He is going to be a rising star in the Republican Party. Very articulate, very combative. He is willing to take on the fight. So that's going to be an interesting story. The other interesting story, in particular for Eastern North Carolina, is going to be Lisa Stone Barnes out of Rocky Mount.
Yeah.
And I think she is going to be a powerhouse in the state Senate. And I think she's a real rising star that people need to watch out for. Has got a strong base within the agribusiness community, has proven her chops in the state house. I really do think put your spotlight on Lisa Stone Barnes, because she has the potential to be a very strong statewide candidate for years from now, whether it's ag commissioner or whether it's lieutenant governor or governor. I think she's got a bright future in front of her.
Trying to do the math, your number that you just gave us for the number of outstanding votes in the state of North Carolina, it's the first number I've heard. You think it's between 80 and 100,000?
Correct. Based on the number of mail-in ballots that had not produced and did not vote on the same day.
Well, I mean, that would tend to be pretty good news, I would think. There's right now, Donald Trump has about a 77,000 vote lead.
Yeah, I don't think Trump can. I don't think that there are enough ballots out there for Trump to lose.
All right, let's do the math on Tom Tillis. It looks like
same thing on Tillis. Tillis was right at about 88,000. I hadn't checked the numbers this morning. I went
96,000.
Yeah,
it's almost 97,000. It looks like
impossible.
Tillis has won. You could declare Tillis the winner.
Right.
And that's really good news for the Republicans holding the United States Senate. He wins. That's the first time I think we can actually look at the numbers and say it would be almost mathematically impossible for Cunningham to come back and win. And probably the same thing for Trump in North Carolina.
Right. And so as the postmortem goes on over the next couple of days, the Democrats in North Carolina really have to dust themselves off and say, they don't have a message that sells. You know, pro-socialism, pro-defund the police message is not something that's going to move that moderate centrist voter. Now, it may get the elite liberals in Chapel Hill and Asheville all excited, but you really got to get down to the bones and figure out how you're going to put a winning strategy. And when you look at the map, Henry, it's a sea of red with a couple of blue islands in the state of North Carolina.
Yeah.
And I don't see that changing anytime soon.
How about when looking at that map, how about Wake and Mecklenburg County? You know, we were on pins and needles last night in the Tillis race because we were looking at the numbers in Wake County, and Wake County's numbers came in pretty late. There was only about 20% of Wake County reporting at 11 o'clock last night.
Wake County does this collection of data in a central location, so no longer can they send modem in the results to the Board of Elections. All the tabulators are sent to a central warehouse, and then they're downvoted. So it's going to be 11 o'clock, 11:30 before Wake County ever reports. Interesting thing to me about Mecklenburg County, Henry, was the underperformance of vote there. There were a huge amount of Democratic votes left at home simply because the presidential campaign didn't put the resources into Mecklenburg County that you've seen in the past with Biden, with Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
So the Democratic operatives down there were very vocal in saying, you're not paying us any attention, and it hurt them, too.
Interesting stuff. I think Trent McGee's got a question for you, Brad.
Yeah, Brad, with everything that happened last night, what does this potentially mean now for the state budget that is still kind of hanging in the balance out there? I mean, Medicaid expansion is still out there with the governor's views, points on that, and the GOP in the state General Assembly, and business tax cuts, things of that nature. What does it mean now for the state budget? Could we see something happen with that 2021?
I think it'll be a cold day in hell before you get Medicaid expansion with this legislature. And I don't think the governor can do anything about it. I think if the governor really wants to look at helping provide insurance coverage, health insurance coverage for working families across the state, he needs to team up with Donnie Lambeth out of Winston-Salem and look at the Carolina Care package that the Republicans had offered to him earlier, really last year.
And you know, let's give credit where credit's due. You know who one of the authors of that originally was? Greg Murphy.
Correct.
Greg Murphy and Donnie Lambeth worked together on that and proposed that 2-3 years ago. And the
Correct.
Governor just won't hear it because, again, politically, it's better for him politically to keep screaming, well, the Republicans will not expand Medicaid.
Right, and then Dale Falwell's election means that there's going to be additional pressure on the hospitals to look at transparency and to be more forthcoming with the state employee health plan. So
yeah.
That's going to be an interesting fight next year. But looking at the budget, if we don't get the stimulus money, whether it's a lame duck session or first quarter of next year, the state's going to have a critical cash flow crisis come second quarter, maybe third quarter, June, July timeframe.
Isn't that amazing?
Simply because
we were sitting cash heavy 6 months ago.
Correct. And we still have about $2 billion in reserves.
Yeah.
But we're going to be forced to utilize that if we don't get some type of stimulus money from the feds to help out
And by the way, this point has to be made. If we had expanded Medicaid, we'd be broke right now.
Correct.
So, I mean, the Democrats don't get that. I don't understand it. I mean, you know, it's like managing your own money. Give me more. The government's going to give me more. Give me more. Well, at some point, the government's going to give out of money, and that's where we are.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I get in trouble for this all the time, Henry, but I say it over and over because it's true. The one thing that Pat McCrory did in our state that he's never gotten credit for is cleaning up our ledger. And yeah. The balance sheet for the state of North Carolina under the Republicans is the cleanest that it's been since I've been following politics, and really since about 1977, 78. Our balance sheet is the strongest when it comes to our cash management and fiscal management, really since Jim Martin left office in 1993.
Yeah.
And he left a really good balance sheet, too.
Brad Crone. Brad, we're up on a hard break. Thank you, brother. That was great stuff. We appreciate it, as always. One of the smartest political minds in the state, Brad Crone. We'll be right back.
Get out and drive at Greenville Toyota. We'll get you out of your trade with up to thousands more than it's worth. We need trades now more than ever, and we'll pay you more for your trade than you ever thought possible. It's time to get out and drive at Greenville Toyota.
Top Dog Academy provides training services and daycare for dog owners in and around Greenville. The Top Dog facility, located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bellsport, is a comfortable, healthy environment where dog owners can feel secure about leaving their pets. Top Dog Academy teaches people how to have a better relationship with their dog. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
We are a unit. We are a family. No, literally, we are a suburban family of football fans. That's our neighbor. Hi, Bob. And that's the inflatable screen we forgot to properly secure.
Pepsi, made for football. Watch it.
Music for your workday with Mark, Mark, and Laura, Beth McCall, and Dylan McKay.
The most music for your workday plays here.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
Greenville Toyota wants you to get out and drive. We'll get you out of your old car so you can drive a Corolla, 149, RAV4s, 219. Plus, get out of maintenance fees and drive with the Greenville Advantage at Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.
Okay, we are going to get away from politics and do our pirate report right now, brought to you by Transportation Impact. Our friends in Emerald Isle, Transportation Impact, one of our pirate partners. And here's McGee with information about this weekend's ECU Tulane game.
Yeah, Pirates and Green Wave at kickoff at 12 noon on Saturday. And speaking with 94.3 The Game's Patrick Johnson on Tuesday, ECU head football coach Mike Houston talking about the challenge the Pirates are up against with Tulane.
8 starters back from a year ago, so a veteran group. They're going to be great on special teams, very disciplined, very physical. They're a hard-nosed offense, a really talented young quarterback. So It's a good football team top to bottom.
The Pirate Game Day Countdown will come your way at 9 a.m. and then ECU and Tulane at 12 noon, followed by the No Quarter Postgame Show on 94.3 The Game. And Mike Houston also confirming on Tuesday that senior safety Tank Robinson has decided to leave the program. He wished Tank well and said he's done a lot, but Tank Robinson no longer
was
a pirate.
A starter?
He was, yes, he was playing, yeah.
No kidding. Wonder what's going on there. Nobody knows. One of those we won't find out unless we read it on Twitter.
Well, I should say he was a starter last year. He wasn't in the starting lineup this year.
He's not playing.
So many players are doing that now. Yeah. You don't play, I'm leaving.
I'm not playing, I'm leaving.
Yeah. You should not be that way, man.
Welcome to the new normal. All right, we're done for the day. Thanks, Michael. Great job in the control room this morning. Thanks to all of our guests. We did not get Tom Tillis on. I'm guessing that Senator Tillis is sleeping. And still dreaming of a victory, which I think he's going to get. It looks to me like we can declare Tom Tillis the winner. And I think we can say that even with these mail-in ballots now, after that analysis from Brad Crone, I think you can say that it's very little chance that Donald Trump cannot win North Carolina. So it's going to come down to those other states we've talked about all morning, Pennsylvania, Georgia, Wisconsin, Michigan. Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania's huge.
Thanks to everyone this morning. Great show. Thanks for everything. We will be back with more tomorrow. See you then.
Greenville Toyota wants you to get out and drive. We'll get you out of your old car so you can drive a Corolla, 149, RAV4s, 219. Plus, get out of maintenance fees and drive with the Greenville Advantage at Greenville Toyota, where our volume saves you money.
We are a team. We are a unit. We are a family. No, literally, we are a suburban family of football fans. That's our neighbor. Hi, Bob. And that's the inflatable screen we forgot to properly secure.
Pepsi, made for football. Watch it.
Top Dog Academy provides training services and daycare for dog owners in and around Greenville. The Top Dog facility, located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bellsport, is a comfortable, healthy environment where dog owners can feel secure about leaving their pets. Top Dog Academy teaches people how to have a better relationship with their dog. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
Hunger and poverty starts here. Your gift of an animal from Heifer International can help a family start a small business, creating food and income for education, medicine, and more, all while caring for the earth around the world and right here at home. Heifer International. Learn more at heifer.org.
My name is Dr. Neeti Armistead, Chief Medical Officer for Vidant Health. The following simple steps will help keep you and your community safe. Stay home as much as possible, wear a mask when out in public, avoid large gatherings, practice social distancing, and wash hands often. It's also important not to delay needed care. Vidant has taken important steps to provide you and your family with a safe environment. Learn more about COVID-19 and Vidant's response. Call 252-847-8000 or visit vidanthealth.com/COVID-19.
Get out and drive at Greenville Toyota. We'll get you out of your trade with up to thousands more than it's worth. We need trades now more than ever, and we'll pay you more for your trade than you ever thought possible. It's time to get out and drive at Greenville Toyota.